was 2016, and I'm excited. Yeah, you guys excited?
Yeah.
Love it. Absolutely love it. So welcome. I think you're in for an incredible treat. I appreciate the fact that you're here because the person that you're going to hear from in the next few minutes is going to drop so much knowledge on you. You're going to need to literally carry it out of the building, put it in your trunk, and then get a little bit out, you know, throughout the week. You're not going to be able to use it all at once. So, excited. My name is Brian Oles. I'm the principal consultant here at Black Speakers Network. Black Speakers Network, if you're not familiar, is an organization that is focused on equipping, inspiring, and connecting the next generation of Black speakers. So raise your hand if that's you, if you consider yourself the next generation. Love it. Absolutely. Me too. Guess what? Our organization was founded. I started my own speaking journey in 2006. And I tell people all the time that during that time, I would not be doing anything close to this. In fact, I couldn't lead two people in silent prayer, let alone trying to lead the Speakers Network. But what I found is that we have a lot of talent. And right now we're broadcasting live from Baltimore, Maryland. But all over the country, there's a tremendous amount of talent when it comes to speakers, when it comes to individuals who are thought leaders, authors. You know, each of you have a particular dream inside you that brought you to this space. And our goal is to unlock that dream and give you a platform to be able to take that vision forward. That's our mission, our vision, just this crazy vision. Who like, raise your hand for like crazy vision. Just like, nobody wants to be on a slow moving train. People want to be a part of something big, something exciting. So our vision, I believe this can happen. We want to help 1 million speakers earn $20,000 or more per year through professional speaking. And I think we could absolutely do it. And this is one of the genesis.
Hey, Simon.
What's going on? So we got a lot of great people in the room that we're going to meet. So one of the questions that we get often is, okay, I understand what BSN is, but, you know, how do we do this? You know, what are some mechanisms that you're going to get involved? Whether this is your first meeting here, if you're watching online, I know we have a number of people that are in Chicago, Atlanta, Florida, New Jersey. These are some of the ways that you can get involved. Number one, we hold these master seminars once a month. It's always every first Sunday. As you can see, they're free. It's an opportunity for you to come, learn, connect with other speakers, and understand how to grow your speaking business. But these are catalysts for growth. We one example, our previous seminar, we had a guy in there by the name of Darren. Darren got so excited after the last seminar that he already is literally 90% done writing his very first book. So he is absolutely taking action. Is he on?
I don't know.
He's on. Great job, Darren. But he's working with another one of our BSN speakers, Erica Goodrich, to do that. But that's what we are. We're a catalyst for growth. Joint venture collaborations. As a speaker, some of you have Hockey's book in here. You don't have to do things alone. If you're looking to create a product, whether it be an audio CD, a book, a workshop, a boot camp, a webinar, a teleseminar, you can collaborate with other speakers to effectively do that. You don't have to operate alone, and that's one of the big parts of BSN. So our goal is to connect you with other thought leaders to facilitate that process. Connect and learn from a global network. We, of course, have a network right now of over 200 speakers across the country and internationally that you could work with, and we're connected on social media. We just hit 700 followers this week, and that was really cool. These guys right here from you making that happen. So if you want to connect with other speakers, other thought leaders in the space, you can do that. Speaker opportunities alert. If you go online and you join the BSN network, when we get opportunities to speak, we're going to send those out electronically so you can respond to those speaker opportunities. Platform Partners is a program. We have a photographer in the room. He's a great example of our platform partner. Mr. Dwayne Benbo is providing videographer services here. But our goal, we want to bring together a network of people who focus on skills and services that you need to grow your speaker business. So that, whether that's graphic designers, whether that's video services, printers, whatever you need to actually grow your business, we are partnering with individuals that provide those services to do that. Grow your brand through thought leadership. Obviously, that's what we're doing today, but we have a couple of vehicles to do that. For you, if you want to get in front of the camera and get on video and talk about what it is that you do, we have a platform to do that. We have blog posts. You could be a contributor for that, as well as we'll be kicking off a podcast and series in May. So there's a lot that you can do with BSN, and this is just the beginning. And of course, we always celebrate your success. So, because when you win, we win. That's why we're here. The four M's of professional speaking, we have this model, which is a tie into what we're doing today. Our 4M competency model says, hey, as a speaker, we know that there's much more to growing as a professional speaker than just getting in front of a room and delivering your content. We identify 4 M's that are critical for you to grow at the same time to be able to do that. Number one is motivation. You know, why is it that you speak? Who is your audience? You know, what has been placed inside of you that you must, like if you don't do it, you're just going to burst. Like, why have you been put here to deliver a message? Who are you going to deliver that message to, and what is your mission? The second M is message. Once you know why you're speaking, then we can start talking about crafting that message. You know, Toastmasters is a great platform to be able to do this because they focus specifically on presentation skills, but then you start to develop your knowledge and expertise in a certain area to become more marketable. Marketing is a huge piece. We talked about that at the last master seminar, putting together your authentic message, building your list, finding your niche. Social media, we're going to talk about that at the next seminar. And then, of course, management, which ties into what we're talking about today. Building out those business processes so that you can run your business efficiently and make money at the same time. So that's the 4M model. And our M that we're focusing on today is under the management category, but I think you're going to fall into pretty much all of these, absolutely, because our topic today, you know, preparing your personal and business finances to be a full-time professional speaker. I can't tell you how excited I am to turn this over to Dr. Maria James, the money scientist. And here's why I'm excited. Raise your hand if you knew that April is National Financial Literacy Month in the United States.
Yeah,
me neither. I learned that like 3 days ago. I was like, how great is it that we actually dovetail right into that topic? But it's Financial Literacy Month, and as speakers, not only is our personal finances important, but as now that we are trying to grow a business, it's going to be even more critical that we stay on top of our finances. But Dr. Maria James is the money scientist. Now you say, Brian, why do you call her the money scientist? Two reasons. Number one, she's actually a doctor, like a legit doctor. She has a doctorate in cellular molecular medicine, yes, from Johns Hopkins University. And I can tell you that when I sat down, when I first met Dr. James, this was over 5 years ago, we met through a mutual friend, went downtown Baltimore and had cannolis. And have you ever been in a situation where you're at lunch with somebody, you're just talking, and you just know that everybody else around you is smarter? Yeah, you just know that they can, that was me. I was like, I'm gonna be very strategic about the words I use because I don't wanna reveal how much little value I can add to this conversation. That was Dr. Kennedy. But she was so great, and she has this incredible technical background, but then she's over here doing financial management. But here's why. When she was going through grad school, you remember, you know, being on financial aid or having to get stipends in college? Well, if you were like me, that money was gone within, you know, 2 or 3 weeks. In her particular case, she started, you know, going through her program, but she also started thinking about money at a very early age. In fact, I remember you actually used to sell frozen cups at age 10, right?
Yeah.
So it goes all the way back to childhood. But in college, she had this stipend. She had $27,000 to get her through the entire year, which after taxes, it was like $23,000. And then at the end of the year, not only did she have that money, she actually saved $10,000. So that's why we call her the money scientist, because she absolutely has developed systems and tools and processes to help professionals and entrepreneurs manage their debt, manage their income, and create strategies to effectively grow their wealth. So she could be anywhere in the country right now, but I'm so glad that she's here because she has a tremendous amount of information to share with this topic. And before I turn it over to you, just want to let you know one other thing. She is also the director, she's the co-founder of an organization called Heal a Woman, Heal a Nation. She's been a part of that organization. She was a co-founder, so she's been there since the beginning, but she's also the director of finance. Very appropriate. So they actually have an amazing event coming up within 2 weeks right here in Baltimore. We have information in the back, information shared on social media as well. So definitely check that out. But she is absolutely going to share some great information with you. So with that, I'll turn it over to Dr. Maria James.
Welcome back to that. All right. How's everybody feeling?
Great.
Awesome. That wasn't powerful enough for me. How's everybody feeling?
Great.
Yes, I'm very interactive, so I'm going to be walking around. I'm not a podium type person. I'm going to be asking questions. If you have a question, just raise your hand. Say, Dr. James, I got a question. I didn't understand that. And pause me so I can answer the question. Make sense?
Sure.
And you let me know if my Periscope peeps have a question. Okay. And I can answer those as well. Okay? So we're going to be pulling up. Awesome. Told you guys, Dr. Maria James, money scientist, co-founder of Heal Mental Healer Nation, and our huge empowerment conference is coming up in about 2 weeks that Brian mentioned. And our first conference was actually in 2004, but we officially incorporated in 2008. So it's our 13th annual conference coming up. And also the founder of Pocket of Money, so where I do the financial empowerment that you were told about. And you can always email me, info@pocketofmoney.com, and the website is pocketofmoney.com. All right, so I want to know a little bit about who I have in the room. So who is currently operating a business? Who's currently speaking? Okay, awesome. So what are you speaking on? And I'll start with the people who are currently speaking, who are currently running a business. Who wants to share? What do you speak on? What's your topic? What's your field? What's your business?
So what I do is I take my own life experiences of coming from a place of physical and sexual abuse in my family and using humor as a tool to allow others to deal with those challenges and issues. And then, of course, at the end, giving out healthy advice for a person to leave and one of my presentational performances to begin healing themselves. And I have been fortunate enough, I have a weekly pop culture political commentary that I do on public radio right here in Baltimore on a program called The Mark Steiner Show every Friday. So I've been doing that for about 8 months and moving into developing a book from those commentaries that I've written. So I'm here to learn from your tremendous wisdom on how to take what I've accomplished so far and manifest it into an actual way of making a consistent manifesting my skills and talents and ability into financial resources. I know that it can be done,
yeah.
And so just learning to overcome that next step of moving what I'm doing now for gratis or for minimal amount of money into a larger source of income.
Gotcha. Awesome.
None of the above. Brian, I know Brian knows, he had a flyer, and I knew about the event. So basically, I'm here just to check you out.
Okay, that's good too. Awesome.
My background is in higher education, so I actually travel around and teach students about like the higher education application process for college. And then like integrate that with like my personal life story, and then bring that together. So,
awesome.
So I'm here from word of mouth. My cousin just texted me half an hour ago like, you need to be here.
I love it. Bold action. Bold action. I love it.
We're gonna see how much.
So is it okay if I do a little bit of business coaching right now? So I know we're here to talk about finance, but is that cool with everyone?
Yeah.
Awesome. So there are some very key things that everyone did when I asked them to talk about their business. When anyone gives you the opportunity to talk about your business, really talk about your business. Show them the passion so that they want to know more, right? Because that person may want to hire you, right? You don't know who's in the room or what connections they have or who you may be able to serve. So giving your name is not the most important thing. A lot of people start off that way, but that's not the most important thing. Because if you get me interested, I'm going to ask you for your name. I'm going to ask you for your business card, right? Does that make sense? right? So you want to showcase what you do. You want to showcase how you can serve them. And you want to give them an opportunity and a way to connect with you. Does that make sense? Okay, awesome. So anyone who has not gotten started yet, but know what they want to do or what they want to speak on, what business they have, you want to share?
Basically, what I would like to do is, my field is thanatology, and that's the study of death-dying bereavement, and I'm interested in educating the public about the grieving process and coping strategies. And you hit on an excellent point. I went to a death cafe, and basically it's not morbid, but what a death cafe is, basically you meet at a local cafe, or it can be at a house or apartment, any place. Basically, it was at the University of Maryland's graduate school. And when I attended the cafe, basically what you do is that you're there just to learn about, talk about death in an informal way, because most people it's a taboo subject, but it's just the gathering of people in small groups, and you talk about your concerns about death, which can range from a number of topics. And you're absolutely right. I mean, I showcased, when they had the introductions, I showed about my passion, about what I wanted, what I knew about the subject. And as a result, at the end, the lady that was facilitating the Death Cafe, she asked me, well, would you like to facilitate any future Death Cafes? And I said, absolutely, yes, because I showed my passion and, you know, talked about, you know, what I knew. You know, I had no idea that that was going to resume into anything.
Right. Now. And so this is also a great opportunity, because now you heard about who else is in the room. So you're able to then, oh, you know, I heard you did this, this, and this. I would love to connect with you. Does that make sense? So everyone is listening. Go ahead.
Hi. I am in the process of branching out into what I feel like something that's way bigger than me, and that is writing a movie script. And I am a my passion outside of my regular day job, I'm a Christian author, and I just published my first children's book. And so now I'm in the process of writing a movie script and looking for the connections and how to, you know, bring the script to becoming a movie.
Awesome.
And even actors and actresses, all of that, A to Z.
Very cool. Yeah, a lot of talent in the room.
Yeah.
Oh, I thought I saw hands. All right, last one, go ahead.
I have not started yet, but would love to speak about relationships. I come from a culture where there's a lot of pressure to get married, and just speaking to people about, you know, looking out for the red flags and not settling for the wrong person.
Awesome. Make your connections. We have a lot of great topics in the room. Okay, saw something at the bottom. All right. So I want to talk about entrepreneurship. So there are a lot of enticing facets to being an entrepreneur, to being a full-time entrepreneur, right? You get to do what you love every day, right? You get to focus on that topic that you love, something that you are going to, you would research it and learn about it anyway, right? You get to empower, help others with your passion. You get to charge what you're worth. You don't rely on some algorithm created, you don't know what this algorithm is, created by someone else, to tell you what your time, your skill set, and your energy is worth, right? You determine and you charge what you're worth. And you also have freedom of time, right? You're able to, there's no clocking in, there's no clocking out. You decide when you're going to work and what that looks like. Sound good? Because I know I was all about it. I was like, yes. How do I do that, right? How do I do that? Right? So as enticing as those facets of entrepreneurship, it can also be a struggle. There are some not so great things about entrepreneurship, right? You have to worry about selling enough of your products or services. Worry about getting that revenue in, because you can't keep doing gratis. Because who likes to eat and likes to have a house and all that stuff that costs money? Mm-hmm. Right? So you worry about not having enough awareness. How are people finding out about you in order to purchase your products or services, in order to hire you? How are they finding out about you, right? You have to worry about the deals that don't work out. So a proposal that you put in, if you've been doing business lunches with a company trying to get them to hire you and they decide to go another way, right? If you don't make your revenue goals, and these are goals that you set so that you can pay your mortgage or your rent, so that you can buy food and all these things. If you don't meet those revenue goals, what happens? So you have all of these other facets that are not so fun, because when you're working in a job, you have that guaranteed, you know, I put those in air quotes, right? Guaranteed paycheck that comes every 2 weeks. Not so with entrepreneurship. So it can be a struggle. It can be a real struggle. And 80% of entrepreneurs fail within the first 18 months. 8 out of 10 startup businesses fail within the first 18 months. Why?
Mindset development, not having the entrepreneur mindset.
Mm-hmm. I'll say not having a clear expectation of exactly what it takes to like manage and grow the business.
Not being persistent and there's a faith when things happen.
You gotta be able to bounce back. I think I saw hands in the room. Yeah? Okay. All of those come into play. But the number one reason? They run out of money. You can have the best business idea in the world. If you don't have enough money to last until profitability, not till you have revenue coming in, until profitability, you're going to fail. You have to have the money to last through that startup phase until you have profitability. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So before we get into it, let me tell you a little bit about how I became the money scientist. Brian touched on a lot of it before we got started. So I did go to Hopkins School of Medicine, and my degree is in cellular molecular medicine. I studied HIV and AIDS. And the whole time, I was also co-founder of Heal Women to Heal a Nation, a woman empowerment nonprofit that's based here in Baltimore. And people consider it a 180 when I tell them I do finance now, but for me, it's not a 180 because I've been doing it the whole time. Science and finance have been my life for the last 12, 13 years. I call it the money lab because for me, it's one world. I take the scientific process, everything that I've learned in the lab, and I apply it to money. For the nonprofit, I created a financial system that allowed us to grow our revenue by 60% in 12 months. Then I learned a little bit more, and in another 12-month period, we grew our revenue by 50%. So taking that analytical thinking, that critical thinking process that I apply in the lab, and I applied it to money and developed our systems. So that's how I became the money scientist. And after I finished graduate school, I was like, okay, I feel like I did something. I had 6 publications. My research and data allowed us to change policy for HIV and AIDS. And I was like, okay, I felt like I did what I set out to do. And so I decided to start Pocket of Money. I wanted to do the financial empowerment piece. That's something that we really need in our community. And I was always getting questions about it anyway. So in 30 days, I had created my first product. I got my EIN number. I went to the bank and got my business bank account, all of that. Created my first website. That's it right there. If you've been to the website, you know it looks better than this. This was the first one, so don't laugh at me. But did it myself, and it made my first in 30 days. And I was like, all right, I've been running a business for the last, like, 9 years at that point, 9, 10 years, so it's going to be good. I'm going to have money coming in. Let's go. And I had the money that I had saved up, and that's what I used to start the business, as well as operate my household while I was starting up. So I launched, and I got one sale. One. Yeah. Sold one kit. I was like, okay, you know, things are going slow. That's all right. It'll pick up. And then... I didn't tell anything else. And there was a lot of different reasons as to why. Different target audience, I was doing online when I was coming from a world where I was doing in-person and speaking and things like that. So you have to use different methods, different business techniques, all of those things. So I'm watching my money go down. And as a finance person, I stayed with a five-figure savings account. But I got good with money. And just watching the money go down and go down and go down. And I also had my little sister living with me, and I promised my parents that I would take care of her, you know, keep her alive. And so I was like, okay, so all of these, okay, how am I going to pay the rent? How am I going to get food? How am I going to do this? Like, my money's really running out. Just, I really feel like I took like a year off my life while I was going through this phase. So I want you to think about that. What would be going through your head if you're in that scenario, if you're in that situation? What would your biggest stressors be?
Paying
rent. Need some place to lay your head, right?
Food.
I like to eat food.
Yes.
So I was like,
gas in the car too.
What'd you say?
Gas in the car.
Gas in the car, yep.
Car payment.
Do not want repo man coming. Mm-hmm.
Feeling like a failure.
Big one there. All that negative chatter that starts going in your head. Who told me to do this? Can I do this? Is it going to work? People are watching me. People are looking at me. Right? So all of this is going on, and I'm like, okay, what am I going to do? What am I going to do? I've got to figure this out. So I did establish a revenue stream. Establish a second revenue stream. But I wasn't making enough money. So I applied for and I accepted a job in finance. I'm like, okay, this is business finance in a large corporation. I'm going to get some new skills. I apply it to the business. I just need something to have some money coming in so I can keep going. So you only fail if you stop, right? So that could have been a fail. I'm like, okay, I'm done. Entrepreneurship didn't work. I'm over it, right? You only fail if you stop. So it's like, okay, I'm going to figure this out. This is an actual picture of my cubicle. Never sat in a cubicle in my life. Yeah, this is blue, gray, don't really know what color it is, walls, no windows.
I like the sticky notes.
You know, there's no really natural light that can hit you. You get a half an hour for lunch. I was always convinced that it was a lunch hour, right? So I was like, 30 minutes? What happened to the rest of 30 minutes? What am I supposed to do in 30 minutes? Like, by the time I heat up the food, sit down, you're done. So, like, and we all agree that we have to eat, right? So how come I also don't get paid for that lunch? Yeah, all types of stuff. Clearly, first time, right? So I'm like, okay, all right, we are not doing this. And I will let you know the, maybe it's been about 2 weeks since I've been there. And this guy was like, oh, on the elevator. He was like, oh, you're new. I was like, yeah, okay, good morning. He was like, welcome to the next 30 years. Yeah, that was my reaction. I was like, ah, okay. Not I said the fox. I was about to figure out how to get up out of here. Right? So I will say the experience has allowed me to be able to commiserate with clients and customers. Where it's like, you want to leave and I understand. Let's figure out your business systems. Let's figure out your revenue stream so you can get the heck out of there. Let's do what you got to do. Because I would sit in that cubicle and I'm just wishing the day away in the cube. Wishing the day away, like, oh my gosh. There are things that you can't take advantage of, whether you're trying to work on your blog article, right? Or you need to do a video, or someone says, hey, you know, we'd love to hire you. Can you come in at 1 p.m.? You don't get off till 5, so no. Right? So there are things that you can't take advantage of. So I learned a whole lot. So how to revise my budget, right? Because as a full-time entrepreneur, that looks a little different. What I needed to tweak about the financial systems that I was using, and personal finance tools, business finance tools, all of that is a little different, right? So figuring out how that worked, right? Also do speaking as I'm doing now, different conferences, workshops, and things like that. So it's only a failure if you stop. So you might not be where you want to be, right? But you're getting the information, the tools, and the resources so that you can continue on and get there. Yes?
Absolutely.
Yes. Awesome. So let's talk a little bit about the business cycle. So you have the startup phase. This is where you're doing your planning, you're doing your development, you're trying to figure out how you're going to fund the business, okay, what marketing strategies do you need to use, all those pieces. Then it goes to early mature phase. This is where you kind of figure out how things are working, you need to stabilize operations, and you want to grow your sales, get more revenue coming in, or get some revenue coming in. Then you have the late mature phase. This is where, okay, things are working, you have some revenue streams established and set up, so you're working on expanding and advancing your systems and growing your profitability. The final or exit phase is when you sell or transition the company. So you may have a company that you want to keep forever, or you may be building it up and later on you decide, I want to go a different way, right? You sell that company or transition it over. What we're going to focus on is those first two phases, because that's where I talk about where most of the entrepreneurs fail, right? You need money to last, to get through these phases. Yes? Make sense?
Yes.
Okay. So let's talk about it. When you start up a business, the goal is to go from low revenue, over to, some people just want to be comfortable, right? It's like, okay, I just want to be able to do what I want to do and be able to comfortable and live. And some people are like, no, I need that multi-million dollar business. Whatever your goal is, all right. You have to start at ground zero. Start with the planning, how are you going to get funded, figure out that business model, figure out the products or services, how you can optimize them, right? So that goes through seven financial phases as you're going through your business phases. All the way from startup down to expansion and elevation. We're going to focus on the first three. Startup, talked about planning, you have more money going in than coming out. Phase two, profitless, where you're not really making a profit, and balance, where you're eventually making enough to cover. So, startup phase, right? This is where you have startup costs. So if you have to purchase equipment that you need to get in order to do your service, right? Or travel or different things to do speaking. So more money is going into the business than is coming out of it. So you have no revenue or very, very little revenue. Like how I had that one sale. I was like, okay. Yeah, no. So no revenue or very little revenue coming in. And you're really planning at this point. Figuring out that business model. Figuring out how you can have scalability. Figuring out how those revenue streams are going to work. Figuring out how you're going to have distribution of your product or your services. Okay? Phase two is profitless. This is where, okay, you have some things defined. You have a established revenue stream. You're figuring out how you're going to have money coming in. And so maybe you've had a few clients, a few people have hired you, you've done a few speaking gigs, maybe you have a product, you have a few product sales, but you do not have profitability just yet. Does that make sense? Some revenue is coming in, but you don't have profitability. You still have more expenses than revenue. Phase three is when you finally hit that balance. You're able to cover the expenses that are coming in. You have enough revenue coming in that you're covering your operations expenses. Okay? So how do we survive through those phases? First thing you're going to need is your survival number. So this is the amount of money that you need to maintain your household on a monthly basis. Okay? So how do you come up with this number? You do a comprehensive monthly budget. Who uses a budget right now? Awesome!
Yes.
Most of the room. Love it. So I don't really have to go through it, just real quick. You know, you start with your monthly income, you do your fixed expenses, those are expenses the same amount every month, that's like your mortgage, things like that. And then you write down those non-fixed expenses, so gas for the car, food, have you, variable amounts. Figure out what your wiggle room is. And figuring out what your wiggle room is and knowing these numbers are going to be highly important, because you have to know what that number is that you have to bring in to run your household. Does that make sense? When that revenue starts coming in, how much do you need to at least survive and run your household? Okay? That's the survival number. When you're doing the survival number and when you're doing your budget, make sure you add these things in. Savings. This is money that you're going to be setting aside now while you're employed by someone else to store up for when you do that transition. Make sense? So you have some floater money. Next line item is business equity. You want to be setting aside money that you can utilize for your business. So if you transition and there's not enough money coming in, or you have a low revenue month, you have some money already stacked aside so you're not dealing with insane amounts of stress. I got those. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Awesome. And then this one seems a little counterintuitive, but it's rewards. Stuff like is tough, right? We all need a little break sometimes where you just, okay, I'm done right now. I need a pick me up. Like, I need a break. Have that money set aside already so there's no guilt, there's no stress. You already know you got it. All right, I'm going to pull from that pot and I'm going to go treat myself. Take a break. Next thing you need is your operations number. So, how much is it costing you to run your business? Right? Think about what you need in order to offer your services. What are those expenses? So this is not a business budget, because a business budget is different than a personal budget. But you can get a quick and dirty calculation from this. Think about what those fixed expenses are. You need a cell phone. You need a phone line for your business. Right? What kind of software do you need? For example, like Hootsuite, that's social media management. That's $9.99 a month. Right? Do you use that for your business? Do you need to be on some kind of membership where you'll be able to hear about the speaking opportunities? Chamber of Commerce or something like that, where you'll be able to go and network with individuals who have businesses to see if they need your services. What expenses are you going to have to operate your business? What are those monthly expenses? Okay? So fixed expenses and non-fixed expenses, write it down for your business so you can figure out how much you need. So in order to do this, I want you to automate, right? So you have money coming into your checking account. Set up the savings account for the personal finances. Set up that savings account for the business. Keep that money separate so that you don't mix them. And then automate that deposit. Because when you automate, it doesn't matter. You don't have to have any discipline, right? So it doesn't matter whose birthday comes up. It doesn't matter what sale comes up. It doesn't matter, ooh, those cute shoes, oh, I need a jacket, I need a coat, it doesn't matter. Because the money's already gone and set up so that you're continuing with your financial goals. Make sense?
Yeah.
Awesome. So now I want you to think about how much do you need in order to escape? How much do you need in order to leave? Your money goal is going to be your survival number plus your operations number times 18. Why times 18? Exactly. You want to be able to survive for that time period where you're going to be in that startup phase and the early mature phase of the business. Okay? So the first year, you're going to be reinvesting back into the business. Right? Taking care of those expenses, continuing to put revenue that's coming in is going back into the business so that you can continue to grow and continue to expand on your systems. Better systems mean better revenue. Okay? Write that down, because a lot of people want to skip that part. I'm going to just go out there. This person said they would be interested in me. Okay, no, you need those systems. Better business systems equal better revenue. The second year, that's when you're going to be able to start paying yourself. Okay? If anyone has a question, stop.
You said Hootsuite.
H-O-O-T-S-U-I-T-E. It allows you to set up your social media profiles on there. So say you have business profiles and personal profiles.
Right.
You can set up your Facebook on there, Twitter. It does Instagram now. It doesn't
LinkedIn.
Do Pinterest. It does LinkedIn. And you can schedule tweets and posts to go out. So most times you're at work, right? So say you want to tweet to go out at 12. Instead of having to pull out your phone and schedule a tweet to go out, you're supposed to be working, you have already set up in there, so I can go out. Okay?
Can you go back to that previous slide?
When you said better systems, specifically what systems are you referring to?
So there are really four major systems for your business. It's going to be your marketing, your operations, your sales, and your finance. Right, so there are ways to set up all four of those systems so that they're all interconnected and running fluidly for your business. Make sense? And I'll go through a little bit of that as we go.
Okay. I have a question for you. Why did you choose 18 and not maybe 2 years? Or
that's what the data says. I didn't pick that number out there.
Okay.
That's what the data says. Okay, so if you're thinking about it, you know that number is going to be a big number, right? So how do you reach that goal faster? And I know when you're ready to go, you're ready to go, okay? So one, financial management. So streamline those expenses. 50% needs, 30% wants, 20% going into savings. Okay? That's how you're splitting up your budget. That's how you're splitting up those expenses. So that you can make sure that you're continuing to go towards your financial goals. To assist with that, automate like we talked about. Automation is highly important to make sure that you are fluidly continuing to build up those savings and investing in yourself and your business. The other piece is to figure out in your business what is a premium product or service that you can offer. Right? Why? You give more, but it's at a higher price point. So if I'm, say I wrote a book, right? And that book is $5. We'll keep the number simple. How many books do I need to sell to reach, let's say your money goal is $60,000? At $5 a pop, like how many books do I need? Quite a lot, right? If I have a premium product or service, let's say I have a signature workshop that I go and do, and I bundle it with a workbook for each individual in the room, right? That's going to be at a much higher price point, right? Let's say that is $50 a head that's in the room. If I go and speak to, let's say, 20 people for each workshop, now I'm reaching that goal a lot faster, right? So what is the premium product or service that you can offer in your business so that you have more revenue coming in? Right? Figure out what that bundle is for your business so you can bring in more revenue and reach that goal faster. Other piece of that, faster path to revenue. I want you to think about a plan to scale that higher price product or service. So what does that mean? How do you have to change up your business in order to have that be the main attraction in your business? So if I found out about you, instead of me being like, okay, I want that book. I'm interested in that $5 book. How do you get me to say, ooh, no, I really need that bundle. How do I get that? What do you have to change in your marketing? What do you have to change in your distribution? What do you have to change in your proposal package to get that to be the premium attraction, that to be the main attraction in your business? Right? I want you to think about that. What do you have to change in your business to get that to be the main attraction? Premium products or service, so if you're thinking like, okay, something, this means it's going to be high price for me to start up. Not necessarily. You can do coaching or consulting. Very low overhead. And you usually have whatever you need already to do it. Because what do you need?
Expertise.
Your knowledge and expertise. So you are an expert in something. I heard higher education. I heard sensitive topics. Right? I heard... I'm going to remember. It was the question marketing.
Yeah, question-based motivation.
Question-based motivation, right? And I had to ask what that was, right? So who's not an expert in that? So if I need somebody to come talk about that, right? I'm like, oh, so what's your prices? What's your services? Right? So you are an expert in something. And if I want to sit down with you and gain that knowledge that it took you years and probably tuition and cost to get, I'm going to have to pay you for it, right? Think about any expert that you go to, you have to pay them to get in their face. So what is that for your business? And how can you get that started up? Because you don't need a lot, okay? All right, so can we talk about making money?
Yes.
Yes. Sounds good? All right. Your business model is very, very, very important. The reason that you're becoming an entrepreneur is to get that time freedom that we talked about and to uncap your revenue, right? So do not build a business where you're going to continue to trade time for dollars. That's a job. Okay? That's a job. If a you're not there, you don't get any money, that's a job. So it's okay to have earned revenue streams where you do have to show up. So as you go out and speak, somebody hires you to speak, hire you to do a workshop, a keynote, what have you, that's earned income. That's an earned revenue stream. That's okay. That cannot be the only revenue streams in your business. Your goal is to get 6 to 8 revenue streams in your business. Have most of those be passive revenue streams. Who knows what passive revenue streams are?
It's when you're while you sleep.
Exactly. Exactly. So, an example of something that's going to be passive revenue, I talked about a book earlier, so we'll use that. So, it takes time and energy to write the book, get it set up, get the copy editor, get the graphics done, all of that. Post it on Amazon. So it takes time and energy in the beginning, but once it's up, you can do a little bit of marketing, right, to continue to get the sales. But you can be asleep and somebody's shopping on Amazon and get your book, right? That'd be a passive revenue stream. So you want to make sure that you're building a business that's scalable. If everything is reliant on your time and energy, you're going to cap out because you only have so much time and energy. Make sense? Awesome. Next piece on making money is making sure you have a strong sales funnel.
I love this part.
You need a very strong sales funnel. So before you can get the clients and customers, they need to know about you. So you start with visitors, right? So say you are speaking somewhere or you're at a conference or something like that, and you have a table. People come and see your table, right? They're a visitor. They have to take an action with you. They become a lead, right? They've shown that they're interested in what you have to offer. You get them to take another action. They become a prospect. They're really interested in what you have to offer. They're really interested in your knowledge. You put out a proposal and get them to be a client or customer. Does that make sense? What are some of the ways that you get visitors? What are some of the platforms that you get visitors?
Through social media.
Yep. If I find out about your profile and I'm a visitor, you gotta draw me in.
Networking.
Yep. Networking.
Referrals.
Referrals are golden. That's gold currency for an entrepreneur.
Vendors, like being vendors that come.
Yep. Having a table somewhere.
What word of mouth?
You want?
Mm-hmm. The same referrals. Yeah.
Products. So if you have products. So if you have a product and let's say somebody, if it's a free like product or something like that, then it has a link to go to your website.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. I wonder where you were going with that.
You saved it.
It looks more like this. It's a little bit more complicated. So people normally think it's like this. Where it's, okay, you come to me, I'm going to tell you about my stuff. I know my product is bomb. I know that workshop is bomb. You're going to want to hire me. You're going to become a client or customer. It's like, no, it's not the way it works. People normally think of like a retail store where people walk in and they pick up something on the shelf and then they buy it, right? So that's why some people think it goes like this. Everyone has a buying cycle. Think about when you want to purchase something. You may do a little bit of research. You have a problem. That's why you're going out to purchase something. As a business owner, you have a solution to someone's problem. So when that potential client or customer is in their buying cycle, right, they have a problem and they're searching for a solution. So first they're going to research it and they may check out the different options, weigh the advantages and disadvantages of those options, then they're going to buy. You're not going to always hit someone in the I'm ready to buy portion of their cycle. So you need to retain them throughout their buying cycle so that when they're ready, you've already showcased my solution is the one you want. Does that make sense? Awesome. So you first have to turn that visitor into a lead, right? You got to get them to take an action with you. You got to get them to buy into you. So he already gave one example of that. Go ahead.
I would just like to share one thing that I've begun doing, particularly through my social media. You know, we all think everything that we post is on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. We all think it's so brilliant. Mm-hmm. But when we toss it out there and we hear, you know, cyber crickets, mm-hmm. We want to, no comments, no likes, no nothing. But what I've learned to do is anyone who likes and is motivated enough to make a comment, I remember those individuals. Because now I'm leading towards a book product. I know that these people felt motivated enough to like, and particularly to set down a few words. So they become special. So over the next couple of days, I'm going to inbox them. I'm saying thank you so much for your comment. I appreciate it. Please look forward to when I am launching this or publishing this. Thank you so much for your support. Mm-hmm. It may take it's an investment of time, but I think it will pan out moving from visitor, someone who just visited my Facebook or Instagram or Twitter, till they were motivated to do something, like or comment. Would that be considered a possible lead?
It's a possible lead, but you haven't fully turned them into a lead yet. Let me explain why. So one, that's great because you're doing customer relations management as you inbox them, right? Because they've already shown some type of interest, as you said, by getting them by leaving a comment. To fully turn them into a lead, you need to get their information, right? So when you inbox them, do you have an email list already set up?
Yeah, I've started that. And that's one thing that I didn't mention that I will, because if you feel comfortable or you want to be first one to know of when it's published, may I have your email?
Yep, exactly. So as soon as they give you that email address, now they are a lead. Because you have their information and you can take them through the rest of that funnel. You can showcase your expertise. You can tell them when the products and services are coming out. You can build that know, like, and trust factor. So before I buy from you, before I hire you, I have to know, like, and trust you, right? So when they become a visitor, they know about you. Now you got to get them to like you, and then you got to get them to trust you. Think about people who have great information. If you can't stand listening to them, does it matter how great the information is? No, right? Like, I'm not like that dude. I'm not listening to them, right? And then you also got to get them to trust you. You have to showcase, you know, what the world you're talking about. So say I did this presentation, and you're like, you don't want to hear anything else from me, right? So that's the same thing you have to do. You have to get them to know, like, and trust you. Right? So once they become a lead, you can continue that process because you have their information. Does that make sense to everyone? Okay. So offering to say, hey, if you want to be notified when this is going to launch, you want to be notified of the other great things I'm doing, you know, add yourself to my email list. So that's awesome. Any other ways? Someone become a lead?
I've seen some other entrepreneurs who's really effectively offer the value first. So you offer to give them something first, whether that is, for example, in your case, like maybe your third, like your workbook. Like, hey, you know, thank you for coming to my site. Like, as a gift to you, I want to offer you this workbook at a value of this amount of money. So then it's like, oh, she wants to give me something and not take something from me first. Or he wants to give me something and not take first. So
you always want to give value first. Always, always give value. Because why else am I going to trust you? You haven't shown me anything. You haven't given me a reason yet. So you always want to give valuable content first. And the only thing I'm going to amend from that is you want to give it freely. Right? Give something for free first. Showcase you know what you're talking about. So everyone calls it an opt-in. Why? Because they're opting in to continue to see more information from you, and you give them something valuable in order for that. So you'll see when you go to people's websites, you'll say, hey, get this free ebook. Hey, get this free cheat sheet. And what do you have to do? Put in your name and your email. And then you get it sent to you, right? So you're getting valuable information for free, so they can showcase their expertise, and they get you on their email list, so they can continue to take you through that funnel. Right? So think of a free opt-in that you can offer to individuals to get them to opt-in and become a lead. Okay? Ebooks, cheat sheets. People are moving away from ebooks just because they're so long, people don't finish them. So think of something short, like a cheat sheet or something like that, or an audio file, short audio file, that someone would want to listen to. And especially if you want to do a speaking career, an audio file would be a great thing. Right? The five top questions you need to ask yourself in order to do XYZ. Right? the five top reasons higher learning does blah, 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 right? What is it that people want to know and learn? Make sense? Yes?
Yes.
Am I losing anyone?
Yes.
Okay,
no.
Good. So after you get them to become a lead, there are some cases where they're in their, you know, buying part of their purchasing cycle, and they'll become a client and customer. You let them know of the other things, or they poke around on your website, what have you, they're like, okay, no, I need this. And they become a client and customer. But most likely, you're going to have to convince them some more. So you got to get them to become a prospect. Right? You got to get them to take another action. So that can look several different ways. You decide what it makes. What makes the most sense for your business, but whether they open 90% of your emails, that shows that they're really interested in what you have to say. If they download a second offer that you have, even if it's a free offer, right? That shows they're really interested in what you have to say. If you have a product and they want to look at a demo of it, that shows they're very interested in purchasing, right? Or if you say, hey, get a snippet of my signature workshop, and they download and watch it, they're very interested in your workshop, right? So they become a prospect. Then you put out a proposal, that offer to them for that product service, for you to get hired. Then they become a client or customer. Make sense? Mm-hmm. Any questions?
I do have one. Are you storing this in like a CRM product or Excel? Or where are you putting?
So you can start off in Excel. I did that when I started my nonprofit. But you definitely want to move to a CRM because you want to be able to follow up. So a great CRM is Capsule CRM. You can start off with that for free up to like the first 500 contacts, something like that. And it allows you to store their contact information. It allows you to put your sales pipeline in there. So, you know, what they're interested in. So they're interested in this workshop at this price point. You know, how likely they are to buy. It allows you to do that with the different milestones. And it allows you to put tasks in there. So, hey, this person hasn't responded to my email, you know, give them a call in 2 weeks, right? I put that in there so I can follow up with that person, okay? So you definitely want to do a CRM platform.
Yeah, I'll be the first one to ask this question, because no such thing, is a bad question. What is a CRM?
That stands for Customer Relations Management. So just basically how you're going to manage relating to your potential customers and clients. So it's a database of the individuals who you're networking with, individuals, potential, your leads and prospects.
Is there any particular sort of program that you might recommend in terms of this?
Capsule CRM, Capsule CRM. So you can get started on there for free, and it allows you to hold all of that.
Yeah, because I was going to sit here and fake like I knew what CRM meant.
No, ask questions. That's good. Perfect. No, ask questions. That's how you learn. Go ahead.
When you're going through this timeline, how quickly do you think someone should be walking? And I know every business is different, but what would you say is the ideal timeline for visitor, lead, prospect, or leads, client?
There is no ideal timeline. So the more you do it, the better you'll get. So, for example, say when you're first starting out and you're talking to corporations because you're trying to get them to hire you and come speak to their employees. It may take you, let's say, 4 months to go through the whole process of doing that discovery call to figure out if they even are interested in what you're offering, getting to talk to the right person, getting to that yes person, sending out a proposal, all of it, right? As you do it more and more and more, you figure out the questions to ask, how to get to that yes person faster, right? So then maybe you cut that down to a month. Maybe then you cut it down to 2 weeks. So it's really up to the person, the industry, and their experience. Make sense? So the key things that you need is that revenue stream. So figuring out how you're going to get money coming in. Remember, we talked about that premium product or service. You also need that business model that is scalable. You don't want to cap yourself out. Also, a strong sales funnel. Convincing those visitors that your solution is the answer to their problem. Taking them down that timeline. Then you're going to have increased revenue. Make sense? So those are three key pieces that you need to have revenue success. Okay? So when you're starting up, money is really, really tight, right? So there's a lot of things to buy, there's a lot of things to do, and you don't really have much revenue coming in yet. So where do you focus your money so you get the best bang for your buck? When I started out, I looked at the big corporations, right? And I was like, okay, what are they doing? Because obviously it's working for them. And I'm going to do that. You just don't have the money to play at that level. So do not do that. Do not look at the big corporations and try and model off their techniques. You do not have the money to play at that level. It's fine to look at competition, people who are in your field who are a few steps ahead of you, and see what works for them. Read their startup stories to see what they did, right? And you can take those best practices. But don't go looking at the big, huge corporations and be like, well, they're making a lot of money. They're doing well. Do that. No. It does not work. So avoid that mistake. This is where you want to focus your money. Coaching. Business development. And coaching development for your field. Once I got a business coach, I increased my revenue by 895%. I had to decide, okay, Maria, I'm feeling real stupid even though I think I'm smart, and I don't know what I'm doing. So I'm going to find somebody who knows what they're doing and can cut this down. So it's not to say that you're not smart. It's not to say that you can't figure it out. But the time and the energy and the money that it's going to take for you to figure it out is going to be a whole lot. So if you can find somebody that can cut that down, you're going to have revenue coming in much faster. Networking. As an entrepreneur, your network is your net worth. So you want to be networking and making sure you're going and meeting people, partnerships, as well as potential clients and customers. Like how you say you go to the career fairs, right? You want to put yourself in the places where your potential clients and customers are. So for your industry, don't only go to industry events. You're not going to find your clients and customers there. You might find potential partners, but not clients and customers, because I'm in your same industry. Right? So figure out who your target audience is and where are they hanging out, and that's where you go network. Okay? Next piece is that customer client management. So you want to make sure that your potential clients and customers and actual clients and customers are having a phenomenal experience with you from beginning to end. Y'all know it's the most annoying thing when you call customer service or you're trying to get something done and you're getting a runaround and they can't help you and it's like, does this person know what you're going on? Don't have that be you. Don't have that be your business, right? So put the systems in place to make sure that you can take care of them, okay? So budget for these things. So when you're doing that comprehensive budget and you're doing those expenses for your business, make sure to put these line items in there because you're going to get the best return on investment, ROI, from these three things. Go ahead.
Going back to number two when you were talking about networking.
Mm-hmm.
So are you saying that it sounds like I'm hearing that you almost need like maybe at least two different network groups, like the one that's in the industry that you're in or trying to get in, and then your customer network group. Would that be true?
Yeah.
That you've got to...
Yeah, so you want to go out and network to as many different things as you can where you're going to be able to find your clients and customers. But if you're looking for partners as well, people who you can be referral partners, then you want to go in your industry, right? So you said you're an author, right?
Yeah.
So say there are a lot of, you know, author networking camps or something like that. You wouldn't only go to those, right? Because you're not going to find clients and customers there. Make sense? Yeah, so you would want to have both types of networking.
Quick question. On an ethical moral tip, I met a gentleman who makes his living writing for a lot of right-wing Republican organizations. But he outsources a lot of his work through the website, is it Fiverr?
Mm-hmm.
He outsources a lot of his work, and for individuals, people of color all over the world, whether they're in the Philippines or in Africa or in the Caribbean, for minuscule amount of money, they do outstanding work. I would just say how you were feeling about that, because we would have to pay you know, upteen times more for those same services here. At the beginning base, you know, I'm just a little bit torn with that because it's outstanding work and so inexpensive. But, you know, I'm dealing with my own sense of purpose. I know a brother or sister here, but I can't offer them $5 to do something that would normally cost $50 to $150. Mm-hmm. So
you have to play at the level that you can play at with the money that you have, right? And the thing of it is, if you hire someone who is in the Philippines or what have you, we live in America, so we have a very biased outlook, American biased outlook, right? Cost of living is not the same everywhere. So $5 here is not going to buy you the same things that $5 will buy you in the Philippines, right? So that's one thing. The second piece is what they're offering, right? So if they're offering at that price point, that's working for them right now. So a lot of people on Fiverr, they do it as a little side gig, right? Just to bring in a little extra money. Some people do it just to get the expertise so that they can then start up their own company, and then they're going to have those prices, that's $150, but they have their referrals, right? So it's up to you to decide what you're going to do and who you're going to play with, who you're going to work with. But I use Fiverr myself. It's up to you. Go ahead.
I actually have, you know, tackled that myself with the kind of work that I do. You know, I had to deal with those dilemmas, particularly being an individual of color, dealing with that. That becomes a dilemma. That becomes a dilemma. It may just be for me, but it becomes a dilemma. So I find myself just trying to get to know individuals as I surf it, because within my price point of what I'm able to afford right now, you know, Fiverr and similar sites are amazing. So, you know, I just want to get some input, you know, about that.
Going back to at the beginning when you asked about businesses, so this actually motivated me and Naima. We used to do a jewelry business. This is actually one of my jewelry. So we used to do jewelry, and we were like really hot at Morgan State. Like people just come in, they were referrals, all the things you were talking about. Only thing is that we didn't really know how to go about it. We started buying jewelry from expensive places and things like that. And then, I mean, yeah, we were getting $80, $90 sometimes from these college students who said they were broke, you know, because they liked our jewelry. So they were like, whoa, okay, these ladies are cute. I don't know. I guess I won't go out tonight. I'm going to, you know. So my thing is, one hurdle that we hit was, I guess, because everybody's trying to do jewelry now. And actually, some people were actually motivated from us to do jewelry. So then they started, I'm not taking our ideas necessarily, but they started doing their own thing with their own twist. Mm-hmm. And we had stopped moving, you know, we moved to jewelry, all sorts of crazy stuff. So then we realized today that we actually are interested in doing it again. Mm-hmm. So my thing is, since there's so many people that actually have, you know, jewelry businesses, they say that you're supposed to find that gap that makes yours different. So how do you find that gap if it's so many, like, different ways that people bring it out? Like, how can you actually find the gap that no one has touched? I mean, we've researched
a lot of different styles already. So
there is not really going to be a gap that no one has touched. There is nothing proprietary under the sun, right? Someone has touched it in some way, shape, or form.
Yeah.
But what you want to have is a USP, a unique selling proposition.
Yes.
Right?
Okay.
So why should I come to you? Right? So it doesn't have to be anything unique, crazy, world-changing, or anything like that. For example, there's a guy who is now a billionaire, making money. What he does is buy old software from like old technology from I think from all over, really. All he does is do a little tweak to it and resell it. Hey, like, look, I'm not trying to be no new, like, come up with no new great thing. I'm just gonna tweak it a little bit so it works better for you, okay? And people are buying it, and they're buying it at a lower price point because it's refurbished, really,
yeah.
Right? So he's making millions off of that. It was no brand new idea, right? Imagine Apple and things like that. When they come up with a new iPhone, maybe like two or three things change. So people are lined up around the corner to buy these things every time. Why? They have a unique selling proposition. So people know, like, and trust Apple.
I guess it's like you have to find out, because I watch, you know, TV talks and things that we both do, and it actually helps, you know, motivate us to figure out, you know, how to do certain things, especially when it comes to business. And one thing is, someone said, I wish I knew his name. I think his name's like Simon
Sinek.
Yay, you know him.
Yes.
He was like,
people buy what?
No, no, let me say okay. Yeah. He was like, people don't buy what you do, they buy why you do what you do. So that's why Apple is so successful, because, you know, Jobs really told us, like, this is why you should buy it. This is, I'm this, that, and the third, and I really care about you guys. I'm not just trying to get you to, you know, do it because I want the money, although, you know, that, you know, at time is it, but at the same time, we're more motivated because he's basically showing us, you know, that he cares about us, and this is the product that's awesome. Well, he's dead now, but I'm sorry,
no,
but
no.
I'm just saying. He set that foundation up. You know,
the thing of it sells lifestyle, not product.
Yes. Exactly. So the thing of it, it's not like, oh, I care about you so much, and we're going to give some of the money to charity. Or no, that's not their USP. Their USP is, this is innovative, it's going to change your life, and it's the new hottest thing. Right? Think of Starbucks. There's a lot of places that sell coffee, right? Why do people go out to Starbucks? Why do some people are just so addicted, and they're like, I'm not buying my coffee from anywhere else. If I do not get my Starbucks latte, it's a prop.
Yes.
Why?
Status. They go to Starbucks because of status.
But how does Starbucks equate themselves with status?
Huh?
How does Starbucks equate themselves with status?
Well, they're selling coffee, and the people who go to Starbucks usually sort of, I would call, like, intellectual types. They come around and
but how do they attract them? They showcase, okay, one, it's very convenient, right?
Okay.
Right? One, you need coffee to caffeine, right? Because the people who are running, I don't have time to be sitting around doing a whole lot of things, so I'm going to service you quickly. And we have meeting space, right? So if you're an intellectual who wants to come and talk, or you want to talk to a business partner, what have you, you get your coffee, and you can sit down and have that conversation.
Right.
Think about like a Dunkin' Donuts or whatever. There's no seating in there, right? Most of it is just like a little bar type where you go in, you can get a coffee, and you go out the door. Right? So there's no meeting space. There's no high status, none of that, right? So that's why people are going to Starbucks. Right? So what is your unique selling proposition? So think about any business that you think about. Let's come to Walmart versus Louis Vuitton. Those are not the same people who shop at those places, right?
Right.
And it's not only price point that distinguishes those two places, right? They have very different unique selling propositions. Walmart is what? Get it cheap. We got a whole lot of stuff. One-stop shop.
Yeah.
Right? Louis Vuitton is, okay, this is designer, right? This is high quality. This is unique. There's only a few of them that have been made. Right? So you have, they know their target audience. As a business owner, you need to know your target audience. What is getting them to buy? What are they looking for? Why? Right? Because that's how you're going to showcase your products and services. That's how you're going to showcase your business to bring them in to buy from you. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
So even though there are a lot of people doing jewelry, they're not all doing them the same. If I go to Walmart to buy jewelry, that's a whole lot different than if I go to Tiffany's to buy jewelry. Why? Right? Who are those people? Who are you trying to attract, and why are they buying from you? Right? There's, think of another big name, Tracy Lynn. Right? They have a lot of distributors. People who go to Tracy Lynn and buy Tracy Lynn jewelry are not the same that go to Tiffany's or Walmart. It's a whole new demographic. Right? Why are they buying from Tracy Lynn? So who are you trying to attract, and why would they buy from you? That's what you need to narrow down. How old are they? You only have jewelry for women. Males wear jewelry too. Who is your target audience? What's their gender? How old are they?
See, we know
what industry are they in.
this real quick, I'm not trying to take too much time, but we know kind of like who our target audience is. Yes, we want college students, so but we also want like that fancy, elegant. So going back to the money that you were talking about a lot of your money in certain places, it's if you don't have that money to buy that $30 each bead type of thing.
So I immediately have a question. How can you, you know, how many college students are buying the high elegant jewelry? Because while some of them may buy it, what is that population that's buying it? Exactly. So is that going to be your main target audience?
No.
Okay, so that's not your target audience. So who is your target audience? So you need to do a little bit more digging, right? Because whenever you think about your target audience, you have to ask yourself two questions. Do they want what I'm offering? Do they have the money to pay me? So I always use the example of youth, right? So say you have workshops or you have programs that are geared towards youth. Do they want to be there? Do they want what you're offering? So most of the time they're there because their parents or a counselor or whoever told them they have to be there, right? So you're already dealing with, I don't really want to be here, I'm here because I have to.
Yeah.
Two, are they the ones paying you? No. So even though you're catering to you, that wouldn't be your target audience. They don't want to be there and they're not paying you, right? So who is your target audience? Who wants what you have and who has the money to pay you? Okay.
She's so great.
Yes, that's true. Let's be real. All right. So, any other questions?
I'd like to give an example. I have a comment. I've been dying. I've been wanting to talk so bad. You know, like, I'm mad that I'm recording right now. But, good stuff. But one of the things that I do from a photography standpoint is, I recently bought a backdrop because I do events, right? And when I bought this backdrop, okay, it's for the children, but how can I get my money from the adults? Mm-hmm. So what I did was I bought a Disney-themed backdrop that has everybody in there that we grew up with. It got Mickey Mouse, it got Goofy, it got Cinderella, it got Beauty and the Beast. It got everybody that the parents can relate to, not the children. Mm-hmm. They don't have no Frozen. None of that stuff that's relevant in their eyes, but it has Mickey Mouse in the middle. And when people walk by, the parents, they say, go and take a picture with Mickey. Go and take a picture, because it's the parents. The parents are coming over with the money, not the children. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that's something that you really got to understand.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's all.
So he's clear on that. Our audience is.
If you're not specific like to any technical industry and you're just kind of on the whole motivational, inspirational speaking industry, it's so broad. Like how do you come to figuring out a target audience when everybody can relate to issues like hope and overcoming challenges? So how do you market
into that? So one, everyone can't relate to you. So this is a mistake that a lot of entrepreneurs make. For example, I taught finance and business. Everybody can relate to finance, right? Not everyone talks about the same thing. So what is it specifically about motivation and hope that you're speaking to? So for example, she could speak on motivation and hope, but she's talking about in the arena of death and grief. Right? So I could say, like, okay, how do I get back to a place of hope after I've lost a loved one? Right? So I would ask her about that. If it was, okay, how do I get motivated to get out of bed again after I've lost my husband? Something like that. She would talk on and she'd be able to assist with that, right? You would have to talk about, so that's still motivation and hope. She'd still be motivating me, but it's a completely different niche. So you have to decide what is your niche on. So it can still be motivational, it can still be hope, you can still be a transformational speaker, but you have a niche. What is that niche? The other thing is not everyone is going to relate to you. Remember that know, like, and trust factor, right? So if you're speaking on topics where it's relating to individuals who are 25 or 30 years old, that's who's going to come to you, right? So if you go, I'm going to go speak at a senior citizen home, it's going to be crickets because they're not relating to you, right? So even though it's topics that can relate to everyone, it's not topics that can relate to everyone because you're not speaking on all of the topics for motivation and hope. Does that make sense? What do you speak on?
Oh, yeah. pretty much it's been mostly so far my audience, I mean, it started off in the church arena. And so that kind of expanded to, you know, I grew a platform in the lupus community and the, you know, I have a, you know, my company is called Pretty and Paralyzed. And I kind of talk about the dichotomy about self-image and how, you know, the world sees us one way, but we have to find beauty and who we are, right where we are, and so kind of, you know, so
I've just heard three niches.
I know. I can't figure out, like, where to stay or where to focus now.
So I want you to ask yourself what it is about the world that you want to change, and how are you going to go about doing that? So what is your personal mission? Because that's going to help you decide what is your passion that you want to speak on, right? So that's something to think about and to consider, because then you need to niche it down, because you can't speak to everyone and everyone's not going to want to hire you. So what is that niche? You already listed three of them, right? So you figure out where you want to niche it down. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Does that make sense to everyone?
Yes.
Okay. So I think my time is up. And I need to turn it back over to Brian now, so we can go over here.
First of all, so thank you so much. That was awesome. Was this helpful?
Yeah.
Very helpful. I have like 3 pages of notes, and I know that it's going to be a catalyst for helping a lot of people get to where they want to be and making that transition from cubicle to entrepreneur. So a couple action items. Number one, if you don't already follow Maria online, please do so. Pocket of Money, first of all, amazing blogs, just like content that you can just immediately apply to your life and business. So definitely recommend checking out a website. We will be taking you up on the 30-day boss challenge, so looking forward to that. And so certainly go to URL and do that as well. And then her 2 books online, absolutely amazing. They're both in ebook form, so I encourage you to check those out as well. And as we mentioned, the Heal a Woman, Heal a Nation conference. You're speaking also, right?
Yep. I'm speaking at the Heal a Woman, Heal a Nation conference.
Yep, so that's coming up in 2 weeks. There's information about that in the back and also on our website as well. So definitely check that out. It's going to be right here in Baltimore, Maryland. But as we wrap up, thanks again for coming. Keep in mind that our next master seminar will be next month, every first Sunday of the month, May 1st from 3 o'clock to 5 o'clock. This location is pretty nice, wouldn't you say? So we may stay here, we may move, but I think we'll be right here. And our topic is going to be around social media and unlocking the power of social media with soon-to-be Dr. Tamara Lucas. And she's looking forward to providing some great content for that. But we'll turn it off here. Thank you so much for coming out. And thank you.